Hello, dear Lana. Welcome to your favorite program, The Knowledge Quest. I'm your teacher, Alex Obara, and I'll be taking you through history and government. And we are on with our discussions on the interaction or the contacts between East Africa and the outside world. So far, having covered the early contacts or the early visitors to the East African coast, having covered the coming of the Portuguese, the East African coast, we have covered the coming of the Omani Arabs and the rule of Sayyid Said in the East African coast. We have covered on slave trade, we have covered on long distance trade and international trade. So our discussion today is going to feature mostly on the spread of Christianity. In our last discussion, I gave you a background information on the spread of Christianity. However, I'm going to take you through it again very quickly. That the coming or the spread of Christianity in Kenya dates back to the Portuguese period, that is the period of 200 years during which the Portuguese were in East Africa or in Kenya specifically, that is between 1500 to 1700 AD. And the attempt of spreading Christianity was largely unsuccessful. And we say that some of the reasons why the spread or their quest to spread Christianity in East Africa were unsuccessful included the following. Number one, there was the aspect of Islamic dominance at the coast. Because the Portuguese mostly dwelled on the coast, but you realize that there was early coming of Arabs during the Indian Ocean trade. The Arabs had deeply entrenched their religion in the East African coast. Therefore, it was not easy for them to influence and spread Christianity in that period. Then there was also the second aspect, which we said that the Portuguese were not very friendly in the administration of their rule during their dominance in Kenya. We say their rule was characterized by harshness, brutality, and of course corruption. And as a result, people developed a negative attitude towards them. And as a result, they were not very able to spread their religion or Christianity along the East African coast. And then number three, when their Portuguese rule collapsed in the year 1698, after the capture of Fort Jesus by the Omani Arabs, we discovered that people in the coast reverted or again decided to go back to Islam. And therefore, as a result, you realize the early attempts to spread Christianity by the Portuguese was not successful. However, this changes with the coming of the Christians in the 19th century. So as they are coming in the 19th century, you realize things start changing. So today we're going to dig into details and discover how Christianity came into the East African coast and most specifically in Kenya and Uganda and most in Tanzania. So I want you to realize that towards the end of the 18th century and early 19th century, there was an evangelical revival in Europe. There was a revival all over Europe. And this led to the formation of Christian missionary societies. In other words, you're saying that as a result of this revival, evangelical revival in Europe, a number of Christian missionary societies whose main agenda was to go out and spread the gospel or Christianity came up. And a number of those organizations or missionary societies include the following displayed on the screen. We have the CMS, in full, the Church Missionary Society. We had LMS, in full, the London Missionary Society. We had the HGF, Holy Ghost Fathers. We had UMCA, in full, Universities Mission for Central Africa. We had the CSM, Church of Scotland Mission. We had CF, in full, Consolata Mission. We had the Mill Hill Fathers, MHF, Mill Hill Fathers. We had LM, which meant Livingstonia Mission. So with these societies, they sent a number of missionaries to Africa with the main agenda of spreading Christianity. So the reasons for the coming of these Christian missions or missionaries into the East Africa included the following. Number one, they were so much focused on spreading Christianity. Remember, we said initially that Islam was taking root. So far, Islam as a religion had captured the coastal towns of East Africa. So therefore, they came with also the desire to spread their religion, in this case, Christianity, all right? So they're coming with that as the main agenda of spreading their Christianity. Number two, they came to abolish slave trade and instead replace it with legitimate trade or commerce. In other words, they saw a slave trade as a humiliation or as an outright, you know, abuse of human rights. All right. So therefore, they came and devalized that activity of slave trade, and therefore they wanted to replace it with legitimate trade. In other words, trade which did not involve human beings as commodities, but different commodities in that case. Also, number three, they came to impart Western education and culture. In other words, they in their mind, they knew that the culture in some sense, quote unquote, was superior. All right. So they came with that mentality that they will spread their culture. Culture is usually the total way of living of a people. So they want to change the way Africans, specifically East African people, were living, their dressing, their eating, and their interactions. And further, introduce education, which currently is called formal. So they thought the kind of information that was offered by Africans was referred to as informal. And therefore, they thought that they could come and introduce their culture and education. All right. And then number four, they also wanted to promote Western civilization. In other words, introduce the Western way of living, because they thought in some way African way of living was backward, quote unquote. And therefore, they thought by coming, they will introduce Western civilization, which will help Africans, because they thought Africans in some way were backward. All right. Of course, that is subject to a debate. But in this case, they thought that by coming, they will introduce Western civilization and therefore help Africans also to see, quote unquote, light of the day. And therefore, that also is another reason why they came to East Africa. Another reason, they came to explore Africa. Of course, remember, before the coming of the Christian missionaries, we had had other European nations coming to East Africa, including the Portuguese, all right? We had the USA, we had France, we had British who had come to East Africa, and they discovered East Africa was a beautiful land, and therefore they want to come and explore. But I want you to note, it's not to discover, but to explore. In other words, to walk around Africa, to walk around and see the beautiful sceneries and the beautiful land of Africa. So that's another reason why they came to East Africa, or rather to Africa. And then number six, they also came to counter the spread of Islam. Like we said earlier, Islam had already taken root, all right? Because Arabs had come earlier during the Indian Ocean trade. We are having the Omani Arabs coming after the Portuguese, and these Arabs had by far spread their religion. And therefore, they are coming to counter, in other words, to control the further spread of Islam, and instead, they are coming to spread Christianity as a religion. So, we look at some of the Christian missionary activities which were done by a number of Christian missionaries. And of course, we shall be able to explore some of these Christian missionaries, and we'll see some of the work that they did in East Africa. So missionary work in the coast, because you see the coast is begun, because that is where they could first reach using ship or using water vessels. So they are coming or reaching the East African coast in the year 1800. and 44. So John Ludwig Krapf became the first missionary to start his work in Kenya. And in this case, we're going to explore and see some of the work he did and some of the missionaries who joined John Ludwig Krapf in his quest to spread Christianity in Kenya. So Ludwig Krapf begins the work of Christian missionary in Kenya. He was a German working with the CMS, Christian Missionary Society. So he was a German, of course, that means he came from Germany, right? And he founded a mission station in Rabai in the year 1846. Remember, we are saying the work begins in the coast, which year? 1844. That means 2 years later, he establishes a mission station in Rabai in 1846. By so doing, he was trying to make possible the aim of the CMS to open in faith the continent of Africa by founding stations across it. So he is like setting a foundation, all right, which will assist in exploring and opening up Africa for more Christian faith, or rather for more Christian missionaries to be done in Africa. So you're saying here, he was trying to make possible the aim of CMS. That means the main aim of CMS was to open in faith the continent of Africa by founding stations across it. So this becomes like the first step towards achieving their aim of opening up Africa for Christian faith. And then Krapf, Ludwig Krapf, undertook the work of evangelization and converted many coastal people to Christianity. So he's making big steps. Of course, you're seeing now he's able to set up a mission station. And then apart from that, he goes ahead to carry out more evangelization campaigns. And thereby, he was able to convert, all right, many coastal people to Christianity. Of course, you realize that the coastal people and Africans had their religions. Of course, there was Christianity and there was the African traditional religion. So he does this, but he is able to convert some from Islam to Christianity and some from African traditional religion to Christianity. And then he also translated the New Testament Bible into Kiswahili. The reason why this is important is because of the aspect of communication. Ludwig Krapf is a German. All right, that means that he comes and learns Kiswahili. And after learning Kiswahili, for this message to reach a number of people, he goes ahead and translates the Bible from the English version to the Kiswahili version. And therefore, he was able to reach a number of people through a reading of the Kiswahili version of a Bible. Then number five, we see he also trained local catechists to assist him in his evangelical work. So in other words, we're seeing he's like making disciples. He's also making disciples who are to assist him in his evangelical work. So that's also very important, because you realize that those who are trained as catechists also played a role by going out, or rather by assisting him in doing the same in as far as spreading the gospel is concerned. And then apart from doing that, he encouraged, all right, there was also the aspect of encouraging more European missionaries to come to Kenya. That means he also told the Europeans from France, from Germany, from Britain to come, right, to come and assist in the aspect of spreading Christianity. And then, of course, apart from that, Krapf was also a great explorer, and he was able to familiarize himself with the peoples of immediate interior. That means we have the coastal town, and there are those interiors which are immediately after coast. That includes areas like Ukambani, Taita Taveta, Athi River, Kitui, and Tana River. So he accompanied Chief Kivoi. Of course, you remember we discussed Kivoi during the long distance trade. Also, this Kivoi was a Kamba chief, and he was able to reach headwaters of Tana. He became the first European. Of course, this is very important that you note, he became the first European to see Mount Kenya in 1849. Not the first man, okay? Because that has also been a misleading statement in most books. He was not the first man. Of course, we had locals who had seen Mount Kenya several times. So he was the first European to see Mount Kenya. And his geographical discoveries arose the curiosity of European explorers. So as he discovered, or rather as he explored, and he was able to see the beautiful sceneries, he also increased the curiosity of other explorers who joined him, right? So you see, he's also playing a very important role in as far as spreading Christianity is concerned. Then after doing all that, he returned to Europe in the year 1853 due to ill health. So because of a lot of reasons, which we will discuss later, Ludwig Krapf returned back to Europe. And then you realize now, in 1846, before he goes to Europe, in 1846, he was joined by another missionary whose name was Johann Rebmann. So Johann Rebmann comes in the year 1846. This is the very year that Ludwig Krapf sets up a mission in Rabai. So in 1846, Johann Rebmann joins Ludwig Krapf. Okay? And Rebmann was also a German working for the Christian Missionary Society, or the CMS. Rebmann also did a number of things in as far as evangelization is concerned and the spread of Christianity. And among of the things which Johann Rebmann did include the following. So together with the Krapf, they established missionary societies or centers, right? Then there were schools, and they worked among freed, all right? So there were those slaves who had been freed. They worked among them. He also was able to penetrate into the interior and visited Taita and Chaga in Tanzania. Of course, that is 1847 and 1848 respectively, all right? So he comes to 1847, visits Taita and Chaga of Tanzania in 1848. Apart from that, he was also the first European to see the snow-capped peak of Mount Kilimanjaro, okay? So I'm insisting on this, not the first man, but first European to see the snow-capped peak of Mount Kilimanjaro. And then apart from that, Rebmann stayed in Rabai till the year 1873. And of course, you see, as he's staying in Rabai, more and more activities are being carried out which are assisting in spreading Christianity further and further. So in the year 1849, Ludwig Krapf and Johann Rebmann are joined by another missionary, all right? So they are joined by a man called Jacob Ehard, okay? So Jacob Ehard also comes, and he compiles a crude, or rather rough, map of the interior of East Africa. Okay, so in other words, he tries to move along and see East Africa, and he compiles a crude map, a rough idea of how East Africa looked like. And he makes his publications, and these publications aroused curiosity, or rather it arose the desire of many more Europeans to come and see how East Africa looked like. So therefore, more missionaries and more Europeans come to East Africa as a result of his work of publicating, or rather compiling, a crude map of the interior of East Africa. And Hedert returned to home, or rather to Germany, in the year 1855. Okay, so you see, there are more steps and more steps being carried out. In the year 1862, of course, we are trying to see the various missions which were carried out by different mission societies. In 1862, the United Methodist Free Church, led by Thomas Wakefield from Britain, established a mission at Tribe near Rabai. So you're seeing again the aspect of Christianity is beginning, and it's being done largely along the coast. The CMS comes, and now we are having the United Methodist Free Church, led by Thomas Wakefield, and he established a mission at Tribe nearby. And of course, apart from that, they also set up stations at Jomvu near Mombasa, Lamu, and made converts among the Mijikenda. So also Wakefield is playing an important role in spreading out Christianity and spreading more and more. So more Mijikenda people are being converted from Islam to Christianity and from African traditional religion to Christianity. In the year 1875, we had Freetown Mission, a settlement of freed slaves. So you go to Mombasa, there's a place called Freetown. So Freetown was a settlement of freed slaves, which was established at Freetown on the outskirts of Mombasa. Okay, so it's called Freer because it was those are freed slaves who had been, freed from the market of slavery, and therefore they formed a settlement, okay, for freed slaves, which was established in 1875. In 1891, Presbyterian Church of Scotland Mission started its work at Kibwezi. All right, so you're seeing they're moving still, they're trying to move into the interior more and more. So the Presbyterian Church of Scotland Mission started its work at Kibwezi. Then further, we are having the African Inland Mission. Now this one from the USA established a mission at Nzaui, and Nzaui in Machakos, all right? So you see, they are moving more and more into the interior. They later spread to Kijabe, Kabarnet, Nandi, and Nyakach. So you're seeing it's happening more and more, and more missionary activities are taking place to the interior of East Africa. So in 1892, as we wind up, the first session is that in 1892, the Catholic missionaries of the Order of the Holy Ghost Fathers, right, built a station at Bura in Taita and Taveta. So you're seeing more and more Christian missionaries are coming to the East African coast. We are going to go for a short break, and then as we come back, we are going to still explore into detail and see how these missionaries did their work in the East African coast. Let's go for a short break, and then we're coming back to proceed. See you shortly. Welcome back after the break, and let us proceed from where we stopped in our discussions. And we are still exploring and seeing on how Christianity was spread in East Africa, in Kenya in specific. And we have seen a number of activities done by various missionaries, Ludwig Graf, Johann Rippmann, and we talked about Jacob Edhart. And we have seen a number of missionaries doing the activities. And so we've seen in 1891, we saw the Presbyterian Church of Scotland mission start its work at Kibwezi. We are seeing the African Inland Mission from USA establishing a mission at Nzaui in Machakos. Then later in Kijabe, Kabarnet, Nandi, and Nyakach. And then in 1892, we are seeing the Catholic missionaries of the Order of the Holy Ghost Fathers building a station at Bura in Taita. So we are actually seeing more and more Christian activities or missionary activities are being carried out in East Africa. We proceed. In 1898, the Church of Scotland Mission, right, set up a mission at Thogoto, right? So they are moving to the interior. They also set up a school at Kikuyu. Later, they extended their work to Chogoria in Meru and Tumutumu in Nyeri. So still the work is proceeding, and more Christian missionaries are coming with the quest of spreading Christianity. In 1899, the Holy Ghost Fathers established a station at St. Austin's near Nairobi. So there is a station established by this, of course, organization again called the Holy Ghost Fathers. And they later spread to Kaba in Ukambani, Gatanga in Muranga, and Rioki Mission, which, of course, are later what mission fields are for the purpose of spreading Christianity. So we still proceed, and we are looking at a number of activities. In 1901, the CMS, the Christian Missionary Society, opened stations among the Kikuyu and Luo. All right, so you're seeing Christianity entrenching deeper and deeper and deeper into the East Africa, of course. Then in 1907, Consolata Fathers from Italy opened a station in Nyeri. All right. And then in 1914, we are having now numerous missionary societies who are working in Western Kenya. Of course, you see most of them began from the coast and then the eastern part of Kenya. But now we are having more coming to the western part of Kenya, which included the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And of course, we have the Church of God Mission and the Friends Mission, of course, called the Quakers. So all these are Christian missionaries trying to entrench more and more into the spread of Christianity. So that's as far as the spreading of Christianity in Kenya is concerned. And I want us to briefly look at the spread of Christianity in Uganda. So in Uganda, this is how it happened. The missionary work in Uganda was inspired by activities of the explorer. That's Henry Morton Stanley. So Henry Morton Stanley was an explorer who came to Uganda, of course, for purposes of exploring in the year 1875. And later, he wrote a letter stating that Kabaka Mutesa was enthusiastic and eager about having Christian missionaries in Buganda. All right. So he wrote a letter to the back to his country, informing them that Kabaka Mutesa was interested in receiving more Christians to his country. This challenge was taken up by the Christian missionary societies. And in 1877, the Christian missionary societies sent its missionaries to Rubaga, Mutesa's capital. All right. So they're also taking up the task immediately. Of course, the letter is written in 1875. 2 years later, CMS sends its first missionaries to Rubaga, which was a capital of Mutesa, the Buganda kingdom, right? So Christianity is setting up also in Uganda. Then later, in 1879, they were followed by the White Fathers of French origin, and they established stations at Tabora and Kibanga. Okay, so these are areas in Uganda. And apart from the CMS, we are having the White Fathers of the French origin establishing stations in Tabora and Kibanga. So the missionary activities were restricted to Kabaka's capital, and hence their work was confined to the following. So Kabaka tried to hinder the spread of Christianity further from his region, and therefore it meant he restricted the missionaries within a given confine or context. So he said they were to, you know, spread Christianity to the royal family, to the Baganda leaders, the count courtiers, okay? And besides Christianity, Islam also had become well established, okay? So Kabaka, in some sense, encouraged the spread of both Christianity and Islam. All right, then other people in Uganda follow their tradition African religion. So we're having like three religions here now. We're having Christianity, we're having Islam, and we're having the African traditional religion. But eventually, there were four revival region groups in Buganda. All right, so there were groups which eventually came in. Apart from the restrictions which were given, we had more coming in, and we had Protestants, okay, who came from Britain. We had the Catholics who came from France, and we have Muslims from Arabia, and we have traditional religious forces. So this one were playing a force. It was like a competition between these four in trying, of course, to pull towards their side. So we had Protestants pulling their side, Catholics to their side, Muslims their side, and traditional religious or religion Africa and religion also trying to push towards their side. In 1884, Kabaka Mutesa died, and a new king was enthroned or put the throne, that is Kabaka Mwanga, all right? So Mwanga was easily swayed. In other words, he never had a stand. He never encouraged that I want Christians or Muslims or ATR or Catholics or Protestants. He was easily swayed, and therefore, he was swayed by different advisors. He could see that the tradition of his country were being undermined. The Arabs persuaded him of the threat of having Europeans in his country, right? So there was some kind of pull to and fro between Kabakas, the Christians, the Muslims, and the ATR. So in October 1885, three youths were martyred, right? Martyred, that means they were killed because of their faith. And in October 1885, Mwanga ordered Bishop Hannington, who was a member of the Christian Missionary Society Bishop, to be murdered in Busoga as he journeyed to see him, all right? So he also like ordered Christians to be killed or martyred in his journey, of course, to see Kabaka Mwanga. And in June 1886, two Christians were still killed or martyred for their faith. So you see, there's a lot of persecution going on as a result of people's faith in Uganda. And then from 1894 onwards, missionary work was now extended to Bunyoro. And in 1900, white fathers began to work in Toro. All right, so Christianity is now spreading out, okay, from the capital of the Buganda Kingdom to Bunyoro and to Toro. Further, missionary work to Toro, Ankole, Mboga, Busoga, Mbale, Teso, and Koki was undertaken by the CMS, all right? The Mill Hill Fathers and the White Fathers. And in 1910, we had the Verona Fathers from Italy who opened up stations in northern Uganda. So the exercise of spreading Christianity in Uganda was not a ride in the park. It was not an easy exercise. It was an exercise which took some of the Christian missionaries being killed or martyred because of their faith. But eventually, we are having more Christian missions being carried out, like we've seen, to various places like Toro, Ankole, Mboga, Busoga, Mbale, Teso, and Koki. And this was mainly done by CMS, Mill Hill Fathers, and White Fathers from France. And later, we had Verona Fathers from Italy, who opened up stations in northern Uganda. So the aspect of Christianity is still going and taking roots still in Uganda, despite the fact that it initially faced some, you know, some competition or some negative forces. So that's how Christianity spread out in Uganda. So we look now in Tanganyika or Tanzania in that case, and we'll see how Christianity spread out in Tanganyika. So the missionary work in Tanganyika or in Tanzania began in 1863. A group of French missionaries, referred as the Holy Ghost Fathers, arrived from the Reunion and started their work in Zanzibar, all right? So they're arriving in 1863 and they're beginning their work. Of course, they arrived from the Reunion Island and they begin their work in Zanzibar. In 1864, we're having UMCA missionaries led by Bishop Toza, okay? They set up a station in Zanzibar and began working among freed slaves. So the UMCA missionaries led by Bishop Toza are setting up a station in Zanzibar and they begin, of course, to work among the freed slaves. In 1868, the Holy Ghost Fathers founded a settlement for freed slaves at Bagamoyo, all right? So of course, you see in Kenya, we had an area for freed slaves in Freetown, but now in Tanganyika or Tanzania to say, they're having a settlement for freed slaves in Bagamoyo, who are, of course, settled there. So the freed slaves are settled there that aspect. Of course, I need you to remember that one of the agenda or one of the reasons why the Christian missionaries are coming is to stop slave trade and replace it with legitimate trade, right? To replace it with legitimate commerce. In 1875, CMS again established a freed slave settlement at Freetown. And then LMS established a station around Lake Tanganyika. Of course, these are now various areas which are being approached with the main agenda of spreading Christianity. Then we have the Scottish Mission of the Livingstonia Mission and Church of Scotland Mission set up stations around Lake Nyasa. Okay? Then between 1875 and 1880, UMCA worked among the Yao. So further and further, Christianity is reaching or is getting more entrenched among more communities in Africa. And then in 1877, CMS set up stations around Lake Tanganyika, Mpwapwa, and Usabiro. All right? So still those are example of stations set up. In 1877, LMS still set up stations at Ujiji and Mtowa among other communities in that area. And then we're having the Holy Ghost Fathers also establishing missions at Muhonda, Kilimanjaro area, and Bagamoyo. I'm trying to give you these areas to see how Christianity is setting out or out spreading out from a given area. It's like it's diffusing out and spreading more and more. White Fathers set up stations around Lake Victoria to the west of Lake Tanganyika. Okay? Then from 1890, the Bethel Mission began its work in Tanga and Usambara Mountains. Also, from 1880, we had the Berlin Missionary Society founded mission stations at Dar es Salaam. So we are having these Berlin Missionary Society, which found its mission in Dar es Salaam. Still more and more areas being covered with the aspect of spreading Christianity. So that gives you some deeper or some overview of how Christianity began from a simple area within the coast of Kenya or within the coast of East Africa, and then spreading deeper to more areas within Tanganyika. And of course, this still continues to date. More and more missionaries now being sent to various areas to spread Christianity. Now, in this case, we want now to try and look at the factors which contributed to the spread of Christianity in East Africa. All right? We want to discuss and look which are some of the factors which facilitated or assisted or contributed to the spread of Christianity in East Africa. And the first one is the role played by Sayyid Said. Sayyid Said, remember, was the one, of course, was ruling the territory of East Africa, and he supported missionaries, okay? He supported missionaries by giving, for example, John Craft an introductory letter which he presented to coastal rulers. So as Craft was, of course, trying to explore, he was given a letter. And this letter is the one which he presented the coastal rulers, who gave him now the mandate to move around the coastal region and even into the interior. Okay, so there's the role played by Sayyid Said by supporting missionaries. Number two, some East African communities, not all of them, but some were friendly to the missionaries. For example, the Buganda of Uganda and the Wanga of Kenya. These ones did not resist. They did not resist in any way. They cooperated and they received Christian missionaries. Of course, not only the Buganda and the Wanga, those are examples, plus many more African communities who collaborate. So that working in close or that collaboration in some way boosted the work of the missionaries, and they were able to confidently move into the interior and carry out the spreading of Christianity. Then we have the support received from African converts, such as the freed slaves, okay? So there was that also aspect of support. The missionaries were supported by Africans, and specifically those freed slaves who had been freed and enjoying their freedom, they supported the missionaries in their quest to spread Christianity because they thought this was a good thing, and therefore we can help them because they also in some way have assisted us to break from the yoke of slavery. So they supported the Europeans, and of course there were those who were converted. Okay, those who are converted also supported the missionary work. And number four, there was the construction of the means of transport. Okay, and in our discussions later, in Form 3 probably, we will be discussing about the construction of the Kenya-Uganda Railway and how it aided, you know, the transport, I mean, the spread of Christianity. But of course, not only railways, but even some roads and some pass-through ways which were constructed also aided in the the spread of Christianity, because the missionaries could be able to approach and access the interior areas which were initially not accessible. So the construction of means of transport also comes as a contributing factor towards the spread of Christianity in East Africa. Okay, so we proceed. There is also the aspect of language and communication. So you realize initially missionaries studied Kiswahili. Okay, remember we talked about Ludwig Krapf being able to translate the Bible to Swahili. So they were able to study Kiswahili, and these assist them to overcome a communication barrier. Of course, this one was one of the initial challenges, as we shall see, but this challenge was overcome by the missionaries being able to study Kiswahili, and therefore they were able to communicate easily with the local members of that area. Then number six, there was the issue of translation of the Bible. So the translation of the Bible boosted the spread of Christianity in regard to Krapf, who translated the Gospel of Mark into Kikamba and Luke into Kirabai. So apart from also translating the Bible to Kiswahili, he also tried to translate to local languages, so that the locals, also those who could not be able to understand Kiswahili, could be able to understand the Bible in their local dialect or local languages. And therefore, of course, that also in some way we can say aided and boosted the spread of Christianity in the interiors of East Africa and Kenya to say. Number seven, missionaries made use of African catechists. All right. And I say this also was a way of, you know, spreading and involving the local people. So as they cooperated in the spreading of Christianity, they also were able to reach the local people and convince them that Christianity is not bad after all. So the African catechists also assisted in reaching the local people. And then there is also another aspect of the discovery of cures of tropical diseases. This was one of the challenges which faced the Christian missionaries. But you realize later there was the discovery of quinine, right? So quinine was discovered, and it was a cure to one of the tropical diseases which really disturbed the missionaries, and that is malaria, okay? So because Africa, or the tropical regions of Africa, are hot, we have a lot of mosquitoes, which beat the Christian missionaries and infect them with malaria, and most of them died. But now, with the discovery of the cure, okay, of these tropical diseases, it meant more and more Christians, missionaries could come and carry out their activities without the fear of dying out of this disease, okay? So that also acted as a boosting factor. Number nine, also as another factor, missionaries also made use of guides and porters to ease their journeys. Remember, we had trade which had taken place, and this trade had established pathways, and most of the people were used to were the porters who could carry the goods and probably the implements and the belongings of these missionaries. So use of guides and porters assisted the missionaries in accessing the interior. So in their journeys, it was easy for them to move into the interiors and access areas which they could not access by themselves. And therefore, that also became a boosting factor in spreading Christianity to the interiors of East Africa and largely Africa. And there was also another factor which contributed to the spread of Christianity, that is the good teachings, which preached equality for all. You realize that initially, more and more Africans were being captured and taken to slavery, and more Arabs were participating in capturing non-Arabs, right? Or non-Muslims in that case. And therefore, when the Christians came with some of their teachings which advocated for equality for all, this was appealing. And therefore, it meant that more and more Africans, subscribed to that idea. And therefore, they, got converted and joined Christianity because it was treating all people equally without discriminating against any of them. And then there were some Africans who got converted with ulterior motives, but again, at the end of it, they became Christians with motives of enjoying benefits of missionary activities. That is, they could be given presents, they could be given gifts, clothes, they could be given sometimes money, right? So as they converted, they knew that as we convert into Christianity, we will be able to get some advantage. You remember, of course, also in the Bible, it is stated that there are some people who followed Jesus with the motive of getting food. And in the process, of course, they were converted. So there are those Christians or those converts who followed the missionaries with the motives of enjoying some benefits. Okay? And in the process, they also got converted and became Christians. And of course, later they were able to learn more about Christianity and spread it further. And lastly but not least, Christianity did not face any serious challenges. Of course, as opposed to the Islam religion and as opposed to the Portuguese initially, these other Christians who came in later as missionaries did not face very serious challenges from other religions in East Africa, especially in the interior. Remember, in the interior, Islam as a religion had not gone very deep. Of course, where they were so much entrenched was along the coast. But at the coming of the Christian missionaries, there was no serious opposition from the interior, especially those who were living, Africans who were living in the interior of East Africa. So these are among the points or the reasons or factors which aided the spread of Christianity to various parts of Africa and specifically East Africa and Kenya, so to mention. So apart from that, we realize that as the Christians were carrying out their activities of spreading Christianity, they faced a number of challenges. I'll take you through a few as we wind up our lesson today. But I know in our next discussion, we'll be able to get into detail. So I'll mention very quickly some of these challenges. But remember, in our next lesson, I'll remember also to discuss with you very into detail. So among the challenges they faced were language barrier. There was the issue of tropical diseases. There was the issue of poor transport and communication. There was the challenge of hostility from slave raiders. There was this a challenge of shortage of personnel, which was also another challenge they faced. There was the challenge of inadequate funds, cultural conflicts. We'll discuss into detail. And then there was also the issue of being deserted or left by the guiders and the porters. And there was the issue of Muslim opposition. So in our next discussion, ladies and gentlemen, my dear students, I'll be able to take you into detail of these challenges. We discuss them into detail and discover some of those challenges. Now that marks the end of our lesson today. And therefore, I pray that God keeps you safe and I see you in our next discussion as we delve into detail of these challenges. Goodbye.